once you really look, you can see, of course, nature hides them. Yeah, it looks like there's at least 20 or 30 right there.
What I enjoy most about the monarch butterfly thing is it keeps me interested in something that's bigger than myself. It gives Mary and I something to do with our time. And monarchs, and not just the monarch butterfly, but we deal with all kinds of different butterflies. We just enjoy the butterflies. We enjoy nature. That's why we live out here where we live. So we're in a situation right here in Jonestown where it's a perfect place to be known for butterflies, and that's what I hope to get Jonestown known for.
Craig said, wouldn't it be nice if we would see more flowers on our way through town? So he just started planting things in front of town hall and in front of businesses, which would allow him to do that. And we would kind of sneak in plants that we knew were friendly to the butterflies.
We're hoping to eventually have a butterfly festival here every year.
How far away do they go, do you know? No, they go the other way. They go to Mexico.
What happens is more people get involved, and the teachers order little caterpillars for Monarch Watch, or people like me will take caterpillars on plants to the classrooms.
These are their paintings this morning of the chrysalis, and their leaves, and their, where the silk, remember the little button of what?
Oh, now there's some
monarchs. How do they hang?
Silk.
Right.
Silk.
They hang from the button of silk.
This is actually the flyway, we call it, for the monarchs. All the monarchs east of the Rocky Mountains fly right through here at about 150, 200 mile swath through central Texas to get to these mountains in Mexico. There's a lot of people involved in the monarch butterfly thing all over the country and the monarch migration.
People are out here at Balcones Canyonlands, Doskin Ranch, for a variety of activities, but one of the major activities is to catch and tag and release butterflies.
So we're gonna take a sticker right here and put it right on this. This is number 12. This has actually an email address and a serialized number too on it. And you want to let it go, baby? Are you ready to go?
Take care.
Okay.
There it goes.
It's a project that is made possible through Monarch Watch, because Monarch Watch supplies them with the little tags that go on the butterflies. The butterfly will then migrate to its wintering grounds in Mexico, and if someone finds it there, they'll report the butterfly via the serial number and call the phone number, and they'll be able to track where it was released from and where it was found.
We've been really successful today. We've tagged over 100 butterflies. And last year we didn't do too good, we tagged 8. We have a butterfly tent that we have about 6 or 8 different species of butterflies up there that the kids can go in, or even the grown-ups if they'd like, go in and look at the butterflies, compare the different butterflies.
I think my favorite butterfly is the buttercup one, the yellow one. Mine's the monarch. Mine is too.
Oh no,
two.
Can we get on the butterfly tree?
I would really like to keep some, but I know I can't.
Butterfly populations go through cycles. Some years you'll have good numbers of monarchs, some years you'll have bad numbers of monarchs. Their habitat is declining. Where they winter in central Mexico, the habitat is getting cut down, the trees are getting felled. But you also need habitat throughout the year. While they're up in the United States, so you need good habitat from Texas all the way up into Minnesota, and then the monarchs even go up into Canada a little bit.
From thousands of feet up, these butterflies see our plants and they come down and nectar on them. We have hundreds of these butterflies stop here every year to fuel up another 700 mile journey to Mexico. So It's pretty phenomenal, these little bugs are phenomenal little creatures.
Personally appreciate anyone that's come in here and done the thing that they've done here, because it's something that really needed to be done.
You take a guy like me, I'm the older than he is, I'm 75 years old. So it's so much here that I can't do it at that age. So we can get some young people in, relieve us, especially me, and I can go sit down.
The mission of Austin Area Interreligious Ministries, or AIM, is to bring people together around the notion of doing good in the community. We try to build bridges between different faith traditions and different cultures that call Austin home. And we think that hands-on housing is kind of our key central expression of that. We repair houses, and in today's case, a church, and we use volunteers from all different kinds of communities, and they spend the day together doing good, doing something really positive, and getting to know each other in the process. One of our clients, an elderly woman who happens to be a member of this congregation, approached us and said, do y'all ever fix churches? And we thought, well, not really, but we asked our volunteers what they thought about the idea, and the response from the Jewish and Muslim communities was overwhelming. They really wanted to help.
When there's somebody in need in your community, if you can help them out, it feels good. And it's actually a commandment, I know it's a commandment in my religion, and I'm pretty sure it's a commandment in Islam too, to help your neighbor. The Muslims after 9/11 reached out to the different interfaith groups, and ours happened to be the Jewish Muslim group, and which took a lot of courage on both parts, because there's bad history between the two groups, but it's worked out wonderfully, because we've gotten, there have been a lot of friendships that have developed over the past 6-7 years.
This used to be black.
Uh-huh.
Covered
really?
In mold, wow. Cottonwood.
Wow.
When AIM said, no, we want to do it, and we want to bring people from other faiths, it not only kind of overwhelmed me from the point of view of we're going to be able to really take care of this, you know, facility that we call God's house, but that we have people that we share community with, yet we have very different faith lives and locations, and that we're crossing these boundaries to remember who we are as people of faith. And that opportunity to come together in Austin, it just doesn't happen very often.
This is what I call unity in the community, when all the faiths come together to help out.
I've really enjoyed talking to Cyril, and it just, you know, it brings me back to the point that we're really not that different. I've learned a lot about her family and things that she's done, and, you know, the way she's raised her kids. I've just made a friend, and I think that's what this is about too, right?
I'm really grateful, actually, to have this opportunity. I do a lot of the kinds of things where you send money or you go to meetings, and those are great, and those are important, those are needed, but I really like getting in there and doing something where I can see the difference.
I've seen this church be flooded with people. Pick up church chairs every Sunday. And I've seen it go down to where it is right now. I really never were, really. So saddened that I thought we was just going to go down the hill, because I realized what God said a long time ago. You may worship here, but that time will come that you may not have a place to worship. You may have to worship out there under the trees. Well, I was ready for that. I've enjoyed this day. These are tears of joy, children. These are tears of joy. Because God has answered my prayer. And I didn't know how He was going to do it. I never even thought it was going to come this way.
This porch now will hold a 500-pound man, yeah. And it won't even bend.
And before, it wouldn't really hold a 20-pound dog.
No, it wouldn't.
Yeah, it did a great job.
They've done a tremendous job on it.
We repair homes primarily in the East Austin area. Our typical client is 70-plus years old. The youngest, I think, amount of time that someone's been in a house is probably around 13 years. Sometimes it's up to 50 or 60 years. Gentrification is all around our clients' homes, obviously, and so we repair the homes. We don't build any homes, but we repair homes to help people stay in their home.
My porch was beat up so bad, you could hardly walk on it, but I was able to deal with it, but Kathy didn't think so. She said, you need a new porch. My back door, it wasn't locking real good, but I could make out. But Kathy said, you need a new back door. It even looks larger.
You are just like
her. What they've done, they looked at her porch over there and they came and done this over here. And now I don't have to worry about my grandchildren running backwards and forwards off
and
the
porch. And they can play up here.
They can play up here and put their dog place out here and everything.
Yeah.
It is very, very nice. I couldn't ask for anything else.
The heart of this program is letting elderly people know that they're not forgotten.
I've been the member of this church 35 years. Since Pastor Amy came to our church, it's taken our church, Bethany Christian Church, to another level, and I'm glad that Amy came.
As a volunteer, often you're doing something that's a gift to somebody else, but you're the one who really receives the blessing. You're the one who grows at the end of the day. When you see the gratitude of the individuals involved and how thankful they are, you've grown as a result. You really change, and that, I think, is the gift for the volunteer.
Martin Luther King died for a change. Jesus Christ died for a change. That was the first one to die for a change. So it's, and we're showing right now that we have a big change coming, whether they like it or not.
Oh, yes. Father, I thank you for dinner that I've never seen before.
Uh-huh.
I'm R.L.Stine. I write the Goosebumps books for kids. I heard there was a big book festival here, and I like to go where the kids are. I try to see as many of my readers as I can during the year. I love visiting schools, and I go to a lot of book festivals, and I heard the Austin Book Festival is just terrific, so I'm happy to be here. All right, well, I thought we would maybe tell some ghost stories today, some scary stories. I think anytime you can get kids excited about reading, it's a wonderful thing. And the idea of book festivals is kids actually get to see the people who write the books. And I think that helps get them interested. And they get to see all their favorite authors and meet other authors and see that actual people write these books. And get to see books all over the place, and it's just a wonderful environment to bring kids. Writing for kids is wonderful, and I always say I get them when they're still enthusiastic, you know, and they're a wonderful audience. My favorite part, I love getting out and seeing them. I also love all the mail I get. I get amazing mail from kids. And some of it's kind of funny. Last week I got a letter from a girl, and she said, "Dear R.L.Stine, I love your books, but I'm having trouble keeping up. Do you think you could stop writing for a while?" It's nice to get that kind of support from your readers, isn't it? Let's say you were doing a scary theme park. What would you put in it? Yeah, real loud, real loud. Skeleton roller coaster. What, will you ride skeletons? Think about what advice I would give kids who want to be writers. And one thing is that kids who want to be writers know it, and they're already writing. I started when I was 9 years old, and I knew I wanted to be a writer. And I think most people who are going to end up writers know it. But my other advice is, it's not advice, but my advice is to read and read and read, and don't just read one author, but to read as many authors as you can, because all those different styles and all those different ways of writing just go into your head without even you knowing it, like through osmosis. And you just have it there, and it helps you a lot. And the other thing is just to write a lot. Write every day. Keep a journal. Keep a diary, just so that you're writing something every day. What got me interested in writing books? That's a good question. You know, I don't know why I found it so interesting. When I was 9 years old, I found an old typewriter up in the attic, and I just took it to my room and I started typing stories and typing stuff, and I've been writing ever since. I don't know why I thought it was so interesting. Goosebumps Horrorland, my new series, is different in a couple of ways from the old Goosebumps books. For one thing, you get two stories in every book, not one. You get a complete Goosebumps story with all the old villains and characters, monster blood and the haunted mask and all those things, and a lot of new villains. And then when that story ends and you think it's safe to close the book, there's a second story that takes place in Horrorland theme park, the scariest place on Earth. The other thing that is different about Horrorland series is that we have this amazing website. We couldn't do this when we did the original Goosebumps books. And we have this great website called enterhorrorland.com, where you can actually go into Horrorland and ride the rides and have all the scares and play the games and also get a lot of clues about what's going on in the Horrorland books. Will there be another TV show? I don't know, maybe. Maybe they would do a Goosebumps Horrorland show. That would be great. This is R.L. Stine, and you're watching Docubloggers.
You will beware. You're in for a scare.
mascot suit. This is the bag. It pretty much gets toted in here. There's a lot of different things in here that we keep. It has wheels. Whenever I carry it around, people usually make comments about there being a dead body in the bag. We have a bunch of different uniforms in here for Hook'em. This is kind of very unorganized today. There's like a towel in there. Usually we have various props in here. Here's a whoopee cushion. We've used it on some of the cheerleaders at volleyball games. Lysol, this is extremely important for the mascot because his head, the head, you can't really wash it. The only thing you can do is spray it out with Lysol, and that's obviously is gonna kill germs from wearing, you know, various people and stuff. It smells pretty, it still smells pretty bad. It has a really bad smell, but I mean, it's, I get used to it, so it doesn't smell bad to me necessarily. My freshman year of college, I was living with a girl who wanted to try out for cheerleading, and so she was going to practices with the UT cheerleaders. And one day she came home and she was really upset and she kept being like, I'm not gonna make it, I don't wanna try out anymore. And I was like, Kelly, you should try out. I was like, and I made a joke, I was trying to cheer her up, and I was like, Kelly, if you try out for cheerleading, then I'll try out to be a mascot. So I tried out and I made it. This is our head. It might look funny because there's no horns on it because we have to screw the horns on. We have a lot of problems with the head. We're always constantly sending these heads back because they don't hold up very well. It gets pretty hot. Usually when I'm done, I'm completely drenched in sweat. I'll be wearing, you know, dry fit shorts, dry fit sports bra, and it's completely soaked. I'm glad this smells really good right now. Sometimes I put it on and it smells horrible. You just have to get used to it. This is the tricky part. So the heaviest part is the head and the shoulder pads, because I'm a girl, I'm not used to wearing football shoulder pads. So they bother my shoulders a whole lot, and also the head bothers my neck sometimes because you have to do a lot of movement. You have to be very exaggerated when you're moving your head around, because if I was just to go like this, like it wouldn't, Hook'em's head would be still. So I have to like go like this drastically, and so it's like a constant whiplash almost. So yeah, the head is what, you know, bothers me the most. So as far as it being heavy, it's heavy in the sense that every time after I mascot, my entire neck right here and shoulders are completely sore, and I usually have to con somebody into giving me a massage. I can see you're here?
Mm-hmm.
Vaguely, like, I can't see you, but I can see there and there. It's like being a horse. This is how I would take a picture. I cannot even see you.
They're doing something, they're involved, they're telling us that they're helping out the team. I mean, they're helping the team put on a show, but they're not helping the team. Yeah, it's a pretty shallow, humorous thing. I mean, there's nothing wrong with it, but it's just what it is.
About Bevo, the biggest, baddest mascot in the nation?
We love Bevo. Yeah. Our grandpa has the next Bevo. He's raising him at the ranch.
It's amazing. It's everything I expected and more.
Well, we have two, Bevo and Hook'em.
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 Hook'em. You know Hook'em? You know Hook'em, right?
Oh, Hook'em, the guy in the suit.
The what? Guy in the suit? I don't know a guy in a suit.
Two?
Should I know a guy in a suit?
Two.
I know he wears a suit and he jumps around.
He's not needed. The real animal's a lot better.
Oh, I just pass on that. I like real mascots.
There's five of us. We're kind of in high demand as far as mascotting. I think a lot of children come to the games to see us, to see the mascot, to see Hook'em, to see Bevo on the field, you know, to see all these, like, you know, see the cannon, see all these random things. A lot of the kids aren't really there for the football game. I think that it's mainly a lot of kids and students that are the main crowd that we aim at.
And Hook'em is the little animated dude.
We like him, he's cool.
Yeah. He's kind of like a quiet leader. Which is like the best kind, you know?
Oh, yes.
Early in their smoke.
Now, this is our favorite grandbaby. That's what I want.
And don't put that on any TV show.
I didn't realize, you know, when I first started, all that went into it, all the time that went into it. And, kind of what Hook'em's role was, I just kind of did it because it seemed like it was something fun to do. Now it's kind of, it's just a really awesome experience to kind of, you know, be around a bunch of kids and, you know, doing something really awesome and them getting so excited to see Hook'em. And it's, you're not yourself in it, you're Hook'em. So Hook'em's getting all this recognition, but I'm not. And I really enjoy that a lot, that I can do something, you know, selflessly.
Katie's great. You can always tell when she's Hook'em. She has a distinct way she carries herself. She's got the energy, she's got the flair. You know, she's got a lot to give to people.
Ideally though, I want to go into pediatric dentistry. There are a lot of parallels between mascotting and you know, what I want to do with the future, because it is very child-centered. When you go to different appearances, outside of football or even tailgates, the first thing that comes to you are kids. And those circumstances are always really awesome when you get to make a child's day. And I really want to work with kids over anything. I have a lot of experience with kids, so it's kind of where it's stemming from.
Become a Docublogger. Log on to docublogger.org to share your opinions and story ideas, or get out your camera and create your own Docublog.